never to be sick. Woo!
Yes.
Got quiet. I got to go see if Timothy's still alive. Like he's out. How do you laugh and mock and make fun of people who take flu shots? Because I forget. What does a headache feel like? What is a fever? Hallelujah. I don't know. I haven't had one in 30 something years. Hallelujah. My kids are telling you they used to make fun of me when I used to wake up every morning. Church. God knows. You know what? I don't do that anymore. How did that happen? Praise God. So you have to desire, and there's a way out of your negative dilemma. Yeah. If you want out. Woo! Church, say amen.
Amen.
So first of all, understand that you are appointed, chosen. Jesus chose you out of all, and we got so many billions of people in the world today. You've been chosen. Your priesthood. A royal nation, that's what it says. Well, let's see how this happens. Has this ever happened before? Give me some biblical description of this. Well, I'm going to go, if you will. Let's go into Hebrews, the 4th chapter. Let's see if I can run with this. We might have to. Hebrews 4 and 15. The Bible says this. For we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly into the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in a time of need. So there, what we have is that let us come boldly into the throne of grace. And what's at this throne? Mercy. The only reason why I stay well is that I got mercy.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Now, I know how to obtain mercy. Glory to God. I know how to pray and say, God, this is my earnest desire.
Yes.
That I don't be poverty stricken.
Yes.
That I don't be poor.
Yes.
That I have a blessed home. This is my earnest desire. Yes. And Curtis was saying that, what's the difference when you come down here and you pray, you just pray a normal prayer, and you get up and just do your thing, go back home for the rest of the week. Or when you know your life's on the line. And God has to come through. What makes the difference between that prayer session and the ones you prayed all those other times? The difference is that you put something into it. You earnestly, you cry. Brother Henry Pacheco said that when his family, his baby was DHS and he couldn't get him out, he says, I tried everything. But then one day, I got down on my knees and I raised my hands up and I cried out to God.
Yeah.
And he said the very next day,
Yes. Things
turned around.
Yes.
So the question is, do you really want God to do it?
Yes.
How bad do you want things to change?
Yes.
How bad do you really want to be blessed? I'm telling you right now, if I was... This, don't get mad at me, this is Williams. Woo! If I was making a certain amount of money below, let's say, 50 grand a year, I would be in here all the time. Don't y'all do nothing up here?
All right.
If I was dealing with some type of torment, hurt on my body, or what have you, I will be in here all the time. If I had something that was just not right, not sitting right, and it's not moving, I would be on that altar all the time. Because I know that I would, until I get my breakthrough. Now we've heard this before, Jacob and that angel. He says, you're not leaving here until you do what? Do I see a difference? You might be an angel. You on earth, but you ain't getting out of here until you do what? Bless me. Now that's determination. I say that God's people were too lazy, were too relaxed, were too distracted. We don't want to really get in and do business with God. I'm going to show you a biblical character who did business with God. Let's look at let's see what does the Bible says here that Hebrews 5 and verse 3. I'm going to go Hebrews 5 and verse 2 first. Who can have compassion on the ignorant and them that are out of the way? For that he himself also has been passed with infirmity. And by reason whereof he ought as for the people, so also for himself offer sins. This is talking about the priest. No man take this honor unto himself. Read that again. No man take this honor unto himself, but he that is called of God as was Aaron. Also, Christ glorified himself not to be a high priest, but he that said unto him, Thou art my son, today have I begotten thee. As he said unto another place, Thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. This is a character that's not very well known in biblical life. All we do know about him is that a mysterious character named Melchizedek and one who commanded respect when he appeared on the scene. Now, Melchizedek's appointment and Aaron's appointment as a priest was not of their chosen, just like you and I. Now, a priest, what's missing in Christian circles today is a strong circle of intercessions. Praying on behalf of the people. Carrying the burdens of the people into the presence of God. That's a practice, that's an art that has been waning in years. Is that you know that your church, family, people across the hall, across the way, they're praying for you. And that's what makes believers weak, is that they don't feel the strength of their brother and their sister praying for them. Now, let me break this down just a little bit more. The Bible says that we should come boldly to the throne of grace. The Bible talks about this Melchizedek being a priest. Now, a priest has certain responsibilities, and he's got to have people helping him out. I say, we got Pastor Hill, we have myself as ministers, and other brothers as ministers. We have brothers and sisters as intercessors. They're called priests. And we have to prepare them to do the priest's work, which is making prayers. So you got to break it all the way down to yourself. Is that I have to be prepared to make prayers. Prayers are important. Now here's the, let's look for those that's got this responsibility. Aaron, you're called, and here's what you got to do. Go to Exodus 28 and 1. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. This is God speaking to Moses, giving Moses this call. He says, and take Aaron, your brother, and his sons with him from among the children of Israel, that he may minister unto me in the priest's office. Even Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, Eleazar, and Ithamar, Aaron's sons. Thou shalt make holy garments for Aaron thy brother, for glory and for beauty. Now here's the deal. A priest, he's to look like he has the victory. An intercessor is to look like, he's to be as though he's winning. Holy garments and glory for beauty. And thou speak unto all the wise hearted, whom I have filled with a special spirit of wisdom, that they make Aaron's garments and his set apart garments, that he may minister to me in the priest's office. Now, you go on and you read from verse 4 on through verse 6 what these garments look like, what they were made of, gold and scarlet, what are the colors, and fine linen. And verse 7 says, it shall have the two shoulders thereof joined at the two edges, and it should be joined together. The curious girdle of the ephod, which is upon it, should be of the same according to the work, even gold, blue, purple, scarlet, and fine twined linen. So an intercessor is someone who's got some strength, got the best of the best, he's victorious, and he's going in to do battle, and above all that, he's covered. He's covered by the glory of God. He's separated. And when he goes into the presence of God, he's going in to do serious business. What he's doing is that I'm taking all of the failure, all of the sin, all of the problems of everybody else, and I'm bringing them before you, God. And I want you to make a difference for all of these people, because they're all in trouble. Now, how many of you like for someone to pray, to come out here on Monday night and pray for your problems?
Amen.
Amen. How many like for, what's 5, 6, 10 people just come out here and present your issues to the Lord on your behalf?
Amen.
Weigh it down with your issues. That's what Aaron was to do. Now, look at Exodus 28, verse 39. Glory, glory, glory. It says that thou shalt embroider the coat of fine linen, and thou shalt make the measure of fine linen, and thou shalt make the girdle of needlework, and Aaron's sons make coats, and thou shalt make them girdles and bonnets, and thou shalt make for them for glory and for beauty. And thou shalt put them upon Aaron thy brother, his sons with him, anoint them, consecrate them, sanctify them, that they may minister to me in the priest's office. And thou shalt make them linen breeches to cover their nakedness, from the loins even unto the thighs they shall reach. Upon Aaron his sons, when they come into the tabernacle of the congregation, when they come near unto the altar to minister in the holy place, that they bear not iniquity and die. It should be a statue forever unto him and his seed. So Aaron and his sons made a priest, brought into the priesthood, given a covering for their faults and their failures. Cover them up. So God, if I come to you, to your throne, don't I have to be pure? Don't I have to be, no sin issues? Don't I have to have everything squared away in my life? Well, the book of Hebrews says, you come to the throne to find mercy.
Amen.
See, some folks don't come to prayer because they don't think they're worthy enough to get in front of God. But our covenant tells us, you come to the throne to find mercy and help. Now let me ask right now, how many are struggling with something? Don't raise your hand. How many are dealing with something? Life is on the other side, not on the positive side. Things is upside down. And if you be honest with yourself, you know the place where you should be is where? At the throne. At the mercy seat. So I can find mercy. And the more we stay away from the mercy seat, the more we get beat up by life. Ooh, I wish I wouldn't say amen. Yeah. Timothy still up? Okay. So let's look at a biblical character. First let's go to Exodus 31 and 7. Real quick. Before we change gears right quick. The tabernacle of the congregation, the ark of the testimony, and the mercy seat that is thereof, that thereupon, all the furniture of the tabernacle. The tabernacle and his furniture and the pure candlestick and all his furniture and the altar of incense and the altar of burnt offerings and all his furniture and the laver and his foot and the clothes of service, holy garments for Aaron, the priest, and the garments of his sons to minister in the priest's office. And the anointing oil and sweet incense for the holy place, according to all that I have commanded thee, shall they do. So God is putting the responsibility on the prayer warriors, the priests. And the Bible lets us know that you are an appointed priesthood. You are a chosen generation. So if we really knew our responsibility and what we could accomplish at the altar, I believe this church would be open 24/7 just for prayer. If you really knew what you had. But most of them, we don't know what we have, so we get beat up by the negative side of life because, number one, we don't approach so that we can get mercy and help in time of need. Glory to God. Now, here we're talking about a priest by the name of Melchizedek. I mentioned him. He was a mysterious character worthy of respect. And the Bible says, you know, where did he come from? All we know is that he's the priest of the Most High God. That's all we know. And there's two things that holds back, two real big elements that hold back believers and parks them in a spot where they can't break through. And I have a feeling that I'm talking to the choir, but maybe I'm not, so I'll go ahead and tell you this. Praise God. Okay. Two things. Number one, he doesn't have an adequate, strong enough, frequent enough prayer life. And number two is that he doesn't know how to treat the priesthood, respect the ministry. Think about that for a minute. He's not a prayer warrior, so he doesn't find mercy. You know, mercy is what? Not getting what you want, deserve. How many of us in here are not getting what we deserve? Hallelujah. And they don't respect the priests. Let me show you a man who respected the priests. Remember this mysterious Melchizedek? He appears, and he commands respect. Who was the first guy we see to meet him? Abram. And then when Abram is not Abraham. Abram is the guy who had a mistake. He's just Abram. Get out of that family and move, and I'm going to take you to a place to be blessed. Abram, come on, Abram. And Abram got up and left. And we're going to look into where we're going to go here. We're going to go into Genesis, let's see here, 15. I do believe Genesis 15, maybe 15 and 1. Yeah. Let's go and make that Genesis 14, and we'll see what Abraham was into. Genesis 14 and 14, when Abram heard that his brother was taken captive, he armed his trained servants, born in his own house, 300 children, 318. Verse 15, he divided himself against them, he had his servants by night, he smote them, pursued them. Verse 16, he brought back all the goods, and also brought again his brother Lot and his goods, and the woman also, and the people. See, Aaron was kidnapped, and all the women. So Abraham had to go rescue his nephew. Verse 17, and the king of Sodom went out to meet him after his return from the slaughter. And the kings were with him at the valley of Shabbat, which is the king's valley. And Melchizedek, king of Salem, brought forth bread and wine. And he was the priest of the Most High God. Here's Abraham coming back with his big spoil, fighting in war, doing all the dirty work. It's like you and I, Monday through Friday, doing all the work, dirty work on the job. Then this priest appears. And what did Abraham, and verse 19, and he blessed him and said, blessed be Abram of the Most High God, possessor of heaven and earth. Blessed be Abram of the Most High God, possessor of heaven and earth. And blessed be the Most High God, which has delivered thy enemies into thy hand. And he gave him tithes of all. Yeah. Why are we missing it? We don't come to the throne to get mercy. And we don't bring to the priesthood the tithe. Glad I was preaching to the choir. And we got people like Curtis getting up saying stuff like he said today. Y'all still love Brother Williams? But I'm trying to get us, Lord, give me my blessing. I want to break through to my blessings. And a lot of people think that a tithe is a whole lot. A tithe is not a whole lot. Woo! When I was poor, broke, unemployed, praise God, I found a way on an unemployment check to find a tithe in there. I wasn't making nearly the money I make now, Brother Allen, praise God. But, you know, an unemployment check, $200, $300 a week. Is that what it is? Something like that. Oh man, I need every dime of that. No, I need to get a tithe out of that. $20 a week don't sound like a lot of money going into a ministry or anywhere. But it's something, it's called what? A tithe. And here's Abraham put his life on the line, fighting, going forth. And he's bringing back the goods. He's won. He's coming back. And then this priest appears to him. He's got his, who's this guy? Who's this? What are you? Melchizedek. Who? Melchizedek. Who are you? Priest of the Most High God. What do you do? I pray. I make intercessions. I stay in front of God. And then Abraham said, you know what? That's where my victory comes from. So I'm going to bring, he gave him the tithe. We shall go and preach it to the choir. Hallelujah. Now, Melchizedek comes from Salem. There was another king that showed up that came from what, Sodom? And this is what he wants in verse 21. And the king of Sodom said unto Abram, give me the persons and take the goods to thyself. Abraham said to the king of Sodom, I have lifted up my hand unto the Lord, the Most High God, the possessor of heaven and earth, that I would not take from a thread, even a shoestring, that I would not take anything that is thine, lest I should say, I made what? Abraham rich. Abraham says, no, I know where to place my money, and I ain't taking nothing from you, because the Lord is who's going to bless me. Now this is what we got to get sold out to. Is that when I give the tithe to the Lord or to the house of the Lord, I know where my blessing is going to come from. See, some of us think the blessing is coming from the unemployment check or whatever's out there. The blessing is not coming from that. Just like when you get on your knees earnestly in prayer and you're praying to God and you are backed up against the wall in life and you don't know, the doctors don't have an answer, the finance people say that you ain't got a chance, we're coming out to everything, we're taking it all back, and you need an answer right away. You said, all I know is that God's going to come through. You got to be sold out. See, the priesthood is for those. Prayer is for those who are sold out. It's coming from God. That's all Abraham knows, that you ain't going to give me nothing. I'm going to tell you right now, you can't say, you'll never be able to say, you made me rich. And this is a testimony that every believer needs, is that you can't tell me, I know how I got over. I know how I broke through to blessing. And you need to say that it was the Lord. And you're not obligated to no one when you do it God's way. Hallelujah. I wish I could get this through. Woo! Sometimes we think the Bible's written in chapters, and it took a little while between chapter 14 and chapter 15. But that's not the way it happened. As soon as Abraham declared, my blessings come from the Lord, verse 15 and 1 kicked in. After these things, the word of the Lord came unto Abraham. How did it come to him? In a vision. He says what? Fear not. Back up the music, let's dance. Fear not. Abram. It's not Abraham, it's Abram. I am thy what? Shield. And thy exceeding great reward. Hallelujah. Abraham said, Lord God. Now remember Jabez. He wanted to be blessed earnestly with great desire. And Abraham is he's not exempt from that. He wants to be blessed too. And he says, Lord, what will you do for me? Abraham said, Lord God, what would I give me? Said, I no challenge. In verse 3, Abraham said, behold, to me thou hast given no seed. And lo, one born in my house is just a servant. Behold, the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, this should not be thine heir, but he that what? Should come forth out of thy own bowels should be thine what? Heir. See, God is saying that I'm showing you, I'm going to tell you that I'm going to bless through you. Hallelujah. Little sister, God is saying that he wants to bless you. He don't care where you come from. You don't ever say, this is the Lord's doing. It's marvelous in my eye. This is the Lord. Hallelujah. Where do you come from? I don't come from wealth. You have people say, I don't come from money. I'm glad you know where I come from. You wouldn't consider that nothing at all. Bible says, can any good thing come out of what? Nazareth. Can anything come out of North Tulsa? Can wealth come out of there? Can anything come out from where you were? But yeah, you do it God's way. Fear not. I'm your shield. I'm your great reward. I'm your protector, is what he told Abram. Praise God. Let's go a little bit further. He brought him forth abroad. This is what the Lord said. Look now toward heaven and tell the stars if thou be able to number them. Look now toward heaven and look at the stars. See if you can number them. See if you can count them. Can you tell me how many it is, Abram? And then he says, so shall your blessings be. There's only one issue here. When do Abram start believing? That's it. When? And the Bible says, the next verse, he believed in the Lord. He believed the Lord. And God counted it to him for righteousness. In other words, you can stand before me any day, Abraham. Hallelujah. So my avenue to getting into a prayer session or something, a day or a month or whatever, it's not.